Welcome to Gaines' Mill, Generals. This is the Union Campaign on Major General Difficulty in version 1.28.4 of the J&P Mod. Gaines' Mill is one of my favorite battles in the entire game. There are several different ways that the AI can deploy, along with varying ways that you can choose to defend the VPs. I tend to divide my forces into three groups. Each group is responsible for reacting to how the AI deploys and either attacking or setting a defensive line. This approach allows me to be flexible, and I'll explain what I'm doing as the battle progresses. As always, thank you for taking the time to check out any of my materials related to the game. I hope that you find something to help you achieve success in your own campaigns. Do not hesitate to ask questions in the comments. Be aware that Colonel, Brigadier General, and Major General difficulties all share an AI profile. Legendary has its own profile. Therefore, things you see me do should easily translate to lower difficulties, but may not work in Legendary or be suboptimal. First, I'm going to run through what I did in camp. Next, I'll discuss how my units will deploy for this battle. Then I'll review what you should know about the AI army before you start the battle. My career point from Seven Pines went into recon. This gives me 200% weapons recovery, but it also gives me full enemy unit information and messages in the battle. I didn't make any reputation buys. I did max out both my supply wagons. My avatar has First Corps. If I had given John Gibbon First Corps when he first became available after Philippi, then he would likely make Major General at this battle. I didn't go that route, so both my avatar and Gibbon should make Major General at Malvern Hill. Lomax has my 1st Division. I increased all of my infantry to at least 1,500 troops. I had plenty of cash, even without a single point in politics, so I bought Harper's Ferries for both Wagner and Brewster. Sherman is the next unit that I'm trying to get to 2-star, and he has Lorenz rifles. Loomis still has 20-pound Parrots, and Woods has 24-pound Howitzers. Grant has 2nd Division. Brooks has Lorenz rifles, and McDowell has 61 Springfields. Merton has carbines. Scale still has Napoleons. Peabody had 3-inch rifled guns, but I feel I will be better off with smoothbores here, so I gave him 12-pound howitzers. Brown has 3rd Division. Porter has Mississippis. Henselman has Lorenzes. And Bliss is my main melee cav. Walton and McKean both have Napoleons. Harland has 4th Division. Franklin was wounded, so I put General Lindsay in his brigade and I gave him Lorenz rifles. Smith is a new rookie unit with 61 Springfields and I gave him an extra 100 men. Braxton has Lorenzes. Keyes and Grimes are my 2 dedicated skirmishers. One has 53 Enfields and the other one has Sharp's rifles. Gibbon has 2nd Corps. Bliss has 1st Division with 3 new cavalry units. Crist has Palmettos, Reed has Smiths, and Ashmore has Merrills. Stewart has 2nd Division. Veach has Palmettos, Buckley has Cook and Brothers, and Bratton has Lorenz Rifles. Martin has 3rd Division, Shermer has Mississippis, and Frobel has 53 Enfields. Merrill has 4th Division. Hunt has 12-pound howitzers, and Raines has 6-pounders. I divide my army into 3 groups for Gaines' Mill. The 3 groups are my northern force, my southern force, and my right flank. Now, depending on what the AI is doing, I will move some units back and forth between those 3 groups. The northern force is the most important because they need to be flexible depending on where the AI units come in. They could easily end up fighting AI units from multiple directions. Most of my 2-star units are in this group. My northern force will primarily be deployed in what would be the southern VP for the river crossing battle. At Gaines' Mill, this location is just north of the Boatswain Woods VP and fortifications. They will move and adapt to battle conditions, but this farm and wood line is their base camp. My southern force will observe the ford that crosses the river to the left of Boatswain Hill. If the AI approaches the ford, they will intercept and likely stay engaged there for the rest of the battle. If no AI units are coming to the ford, Some of them will move up to support my northern force or flank the AI units coming through the swampy area of the river crossing. A few of my southern units will stay near the VP and selectively man the fortifications. Loomis's 20-pound Parrot battery will be centrally placed within the southern forces so he can support both groups and even rotate fire north or west if needed. My right flank force will primarily be 2nd Corps. I will deploy some detached skirmishers from infantry in the 1st Corps for scouting and to delay the AI flanking force. I've never played this relying so much on cav and skirmishers to handle the majority of the fighting that's on the right flank, but I'm going to try it. The first three divisions of 1st Corps will deploy as soon as the battle starts. 4th Division is the earliest reinforcements. They arrive about an hour and 9 minutes left in Phase 2. At that point, the battle is almost 2 hours old. All 2nd Corps troops arrive at the start of Phase 3. Then you have 2.5 hours to win the battle. Following Seven Pines, the AI Army received 2 reinforcements. One is a full corps of 22,000, and the other is 11,000 veterans. According to the Corps deployment screen, the AI has 46,958 soldiers with 114 guns, and I have 25,005 men and 89 guns. After splits, the AI will end up outnumbering me 2-1. With 10 in recon, I can start reviewing the AI army before every battle to better understand unit size, weapons, and how many units will deploy with each commander. The AI infantry are all 2-star units, most have 53 Enfields, a few have Harper's Ferries, Lorenzes, or Mississippis. The artillery and skirmishers are 1-star units with a mix of weapons, lots of Sharps carbines, and Napoleons. Not counting unit splits, the largest AI deployment in the battle will be AP Hill at the beginning. He has 2 divisions and always comes in from the northeast. He also has the only dedicated skirmisher units that the AI has. D.H. Hill leads the flanking force that comes in from the northwest. They deploy in Phase 2. The detached skirmishers will move forward quickly, but the infantry and artillery don't really get close enough to engage until the start of Phase 3. The AI's 3rd Corps consists of 7 infantry and 2 artillery batteries. However, they deploy in 2 groups. Ewell would come in with a division early in Phase 2. Then Jackson will come in with the other division midway through Phase 3. Jackson is the last group to deploy into the battle. Longstreet has the AI's 4th Corps, just a division of 3 infantry and 1 artillery. Longstreet arrives early in Phase 3. We know when and where AP Hill and DHL will deploy. For Ewell, Longstreet, and Jackson, we know approximately when they will deploy, but we don't know where. Since Longstreet and Jackson deploy in Phase 3 after all of my units are on the field, I don't worry about them. Ewell is the one that I monitor, so I know where I need to shift my forces. I find this battle to be a great balance between challenge and fun. Although DHL will deploy in Phase 2, I really have all of Phases 1 and 2 to eliminate Ewell and AP Hill's units before I need to give any attention to the other divisions that will deploy in Phase 3. My cav and a detached skirmisher will go to the far right to check for any skirmishers. They can also scout for any AI coming in from the north. Once they eliminate the skirmisher, I will try to get on the north side of any AI units that are coming in so I can flank and see how many there are in each group. If the AI comes in from the immediate left at the ford, then I would move my infantry and artillery up to intercept them for a while and eventually fall back to the fortifications. If they don't come from that direction, then I'm better off just keeping a detached out in front to scout and let my other units set up to support my northern force. I would have had units right up defending the river in the past, but it's easy for the AI units to get great coverage in that area. By staying back, I force the AI to leave the cover to advance into the open. The unit coming in from the river is the lead of a second group coming down on an angle, which means nobody is coming in from the left for at least 34 minutes, so I can move my skirmishers to intercept. Thank you. have 3 smooth bores to support my infantry, and I like the placement of my 20-pound Parrots because they can cover to the north, east, and west. I'll see if I can work my cav around behind without getting into trouble to try to take out the artillery and any routing units. I want this infantry to have a clear path to walk right up to my line to take fire. I also need my skirmishers to take a couple of shots from artillery to give my cav time to charge without taking canister hits. This unit can definitely charge, but they're not going to make it. I need to pull those artillery off before Henselman gets lit up by my own guns. Thank you. I know one of the artillery is now firing, so let's try this. Phase 2 is starting soon, so I need to move my cav back out of here once the artillery is gone. Hopefully the reinforcements will come in from the same direction as the first two units, otherwise I'll have to shift some of my guys around. I need my cav to get out of range of that infantry, and I need to move some help up to the north end. A skirmisher on my left now, so troops might be coming in from the immediate left side. I can send my cav left to verify the AI position, or I can go to the right to help my right flank. If units are coming in from the left, I don't want any of my guys in the fortifications taking on multiple AI units. I'll pull them and my artillery back a bit to form a defensive line that fits with my northern force. That way I can shift guys back and forth to support them. quarter of my KF can start collapsing the AI flank on this end. My skirmishers keep getting flanked from the rear, trying to pull back here. I thought the AI was crossing the ford, but with the jam pile of units in the center, maybe I misread it. I got the message that Ewell's division is attacking, but I haven't seen him yet. There he is. That makes three groups in a row coming in from the northeast. I could shift my southern guys a bit to provide more support to the north. I'll send a detached skirmisher to scout the ford just to be sure. Everything looks like an expanded version of River Crossing up to this point. Yule brought a division, and it's clear some of them came towards the north end, so I don't expect that one unit driving towards the south to have much company. There are at least 2.5 divisions in that north and center, taking a lot of fire from my best units. I assumed Porter would likely be charged. I'll see if my cav and detached skirmishers can slow this down. They stopped. I need to pour on a bunch of fire to rout them before they start again. I'm going to cancel that charge with Anderson and Field sitting back there to flank me. That worked well. Both are headed back the other way. Looking pretty good on all fronts. The AI is losing men and morale at a good pace. Ah! The right flank forces will arrive in about 25 minutes. I'd love to eliminate some of these guys before then to take some of the heat off my left so I can divert some forces to the right. In the past, I would send this group straight north to intercept the flanking force. However, it takes a while for that flanking force to get down here, so these guys end up sitting around a lot. Therefore, I will send them up to the middle VP and then decide the best place for them. I won't worry too much about McGee Hill until my last group of reinforcement comes in at the beginning of Phase 3. I have no idea if I can get the supply wagon over to my lines before the reinforcements come in and take it back. I'll start sending some scouts to watch for the AI flanking force. I still haven't captured Boatswain Woods. I wonder if that would influence the AI to hit that way rather than McGee Hill. I'm not really sure. those AI units in the center are in a bad place. If the AI didn't have so many more units coming in, I would be tempted to charge a bunch of my guys to start capturing, but I want to keep my condition up. Try and route that artillery so it'll stop firing for a bit. AI scouts are starting to show up on the right. I don't want to lose too many cav, but taking Seymour's unit while it goes after the supply wagon would be nice. Close enough, so let's charge. While Anderson has turned around gawking, I'll flank him. That's another big skirmisher hiding right there. I need to get my cav away from that. You have to be careful not to get carried away with pursuing other units in this battle, because you may end up out of position when the AI reinforcements show up, and then things get messy. So I'll pull Porter and Sherman back into cover for now, at least until I know where the next group is coming from. The AI should have infantry rolling up here soon. I'll have two infantry go to Boatswain Woods to prepare for the AI flank attack, and I'll send the third one up to my defensive line. Time to send my cav over to find the AI artillery and supply wagons. McDowell is finally getting into the action. The fortifications are not horrible for repelling charges. Both my dedicated skirmishers can support with flanking fire. DH Hill is arriving on the right flank. I have two more divisions coming in the last phase. Jackson and Longstreet will be arriving somewhere in that last phase. So I don't want to shift too many of my guys off the left flank until I know where they're coming from. I also need to get these two skirmishers back across the river before the last phase. I can't see it on the battlefield, but the mini-map indicates there's a unit right in front of me. I'll take a free supply wagon if you're offering one. My charging skirmishers still haven't caught the wagon, so I better pull them back and wait. Starting the last phase. Other than two light guns, my reinforcements are skirmishers and cav, so they can get into position fast. Like I said, I've never used all skirmishers and cav to handle the AI flanking force, so we'll see how this goes. The AI just got one more reinforcement. Jackson is a corps commander, but half his men came in with Ewell, so he and Longstreet each have a division. I may have to pull Porter and Sherman back later, but for now I'll let them flank from the north. I'll also send Brewster to the center VP. The AI skirmishers are making good progress towards McGee Hill, but it won't last. My melee cav are charging, and I'm sending carbine cav to support. Given the size of the skirmishers, one of their perks is the tier 2 maneuver and size perk. Recruit melee units are not very effective. I should have had carbine calf fire several shots first. Whoa, I don't want to get into all that. I'll try to pull my cav back. Most of the flanking force appears to be going towards Boatswain rather than McGee. Thank you. AI units are starting to come down to my southern left flank now. I need to send some of my support that way. I still don't see any new units coming in from the right. That supply wagon has been teasing me. I'll send my cav after it finally. I have about 5 infantry brigades to handle on this side. There's plenty of time to chip away at them with the mobile forces that I have here. In hindsight, I moved too quickly attacking with my KF. I should have waited for my skirmishers and artillery to come up to get into place. It's a little haphazard now. Wilcox is coming up. That's a new unit, so I'll assume he's part of Longstreet's division. They'll be putting more pressure on my left flank. I see three healthy and heroic units rolling up here now, so things might get interesting. Those two are routing, if I remember correctly. Jackson comes in kind of late, so I should have some time to concentrate on this big group before he arrives with more. There's really a difference between being somewhat offensive and being completely defensive. If Jackson arrived right now, I'd be playing defensive the rest of the battle on this left flank. Right now, I can still maintain control and can attack between repelling charges. The more I keep collapsing his left flank, the more I can box him in and try to capture and shatter some units. The AI charging deep into my line is a good thing. It helps me isolate them. I have multiple infantry units routing now. I need my skirmishers to hold things down for a bit. Having that 10 in recon always throws me off a bit when messages for enemy units start popping up. But it looks like we've killed Longstreet. Fortunately, most of the AI units have poor morale right now. Now Ewell has been killed. Keep charging, I have lots of canisters that I can give you. Thank you. That's likely Jackson's division starting to come in, so Porter, Sherman, and a couple of skirmishers should be able to hold him up. The AI still has a large force on the field, as unorganized as it might be. Thank you. The AI must have had Longstreet both as a division commander and a corps commander, since the corps is right there behind his infantry, even though we got the message saying that we killed him. The AI is down to two infantry units left on this side, plus that skirmisher. It shouldn't take long to finish them up here, and everyone can head to the left flank. I need to reposition a few units to keep Jackson in front of me and not let him get behind, but I should be able to just hold him up right here. Right flank's almost done. Thank you. Part of my cab will go south and track down that skirmisher. Part of them will go north and see if anyone else was able to sneak across the river behind me. I have a lot of tired units, so I don't know if I'll be able to clean up the rest of the AA. Porter went down. These units in the woods for Jackson will be hard to eliminate before time runs out. Most of my cav are inexperienced, so they don't do well versus two-star infantry. Plus, he's sitting on an artillery battery. I'll focus on taking out the rest of the troops in the south and see what happens. Maybe Jackson's troops will charge or do something stupid. Stealing this supply wagon is probably the last move I can make with the few minutes that are remaining. Not a bad outcome overall. I could have better micromanaged my cav and skirmishers on that right flank. I had 1,595 men killed, 4,512 wounded, and 554 missing. My total casualties were 6,862. The AI had 27,960 casualties and 6,363 captured. Wagner and Brewster have the most kills, as I would expect. I see the AI had 1 2-star artillery. Several lieutenant colonels made it to full bird, and Loomis and Henselman made general. A lot of 53 Enfields and Napoleons, a few Lorenzes and Sharps carbines, over 40,000 in supplies captured. I will get my CSA campaign caught up to Gaines' Mill and then come back to the Union for Malvern Hill. Thank you so much for spending some of your valuable time watching today. I hope you found something useful for your campaigns, and I wish you much success, Generals.